19. At this point in time, I will ask the secretary to call the roll. At this time, I want to remind everybody that we have a new protocol for calling the roll. Please, when your name is announced, say aye and acknowledge it, and also use the button on your console to push to register that you are here. Thank you.
Barnstable Fred Jerogatis.
Here.
Bourne Stephen Mealy.
Here.
Brewster Elizabeth Taylor. Here. Chatham Tom Wilson.
Here.
Dennis Richard Roy.
Here.
Eastham Joy Brookshire.
Here.
Falmouth Charles McCaffrey.
Here.
Harwich Jacqueline Edson. Mashpee Ernest Virgilio.
Here.
Orleans Len Short.
Here.
Provincetown Dr. Cheryl Andrews.
Here.
Sandwich Harold Mitchell. Truro Kevin Grunewald. Wellfleet is vacant. Yarmouth John McCormick Jr.
Here.
County Commissioner Ronald Bergstrom.
Here.
Minority Representative John Harris. Native American Representative David Whedon. And Governor's appointee Michael Maxim. We have a quorum.
I'm still getting used to this console myself. Anyway, at any rate, at this time, if there is anyone in the public who would like to make a statement or a comment to the commission, other than what is on the agenda, please come forward. Seeing none, we'll move along. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is the approval of minutes. The minutes of May 30th, 2019.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Are any comments on the minutes? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Two abstentions. Next item on the agenda is the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy. And we're going to have a presentation from the staff at this time, Leslie Richardson.
Thank you. So I'm Leslie Richardson, the Cape Cod Commission's Economic Development Officer. I think this is going to flip. Where did Ian go? Thank you. So I'm here today to present to you the five-year update of the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy. So this is a plan that we do a major update every 5 years, and then on an annual basis, I come back to you with an annual report to let you know how we're doing at implementing the plan. So this is a altogether new plan. We started the planning process back in November with the said strategy committee. For those of you who may not be familiar with the structure, the said strategy committee is the Barnstable County Economic Development Council, which is an advisory board to the county commissioners and works with the Cape Cod Commission on all economic development related activities. We had a major kickoff in January with stakeholders, and then we had a whole stakeholders process organized around specific work groups to do with infrastructure, workforce and sector development, and then business development and business climate. And then we drafted the report and it went out for public comment. So now we are in the approval period. Last Thursday, the Barnstable County EDC did approve this document, and so it just needs Cape Cod Commission approval to be sent to the U.S. Economic Development Administration, which is a department within the Department of Commerce. And they provide the structure for the SEDS, and they also provide us with, they certify the SEDS, and then if the SEDS is certified, then towns within the region are eligible for EDA funds. And we are eligible for an economic development district designation, which we did receive back in 2013. And to maintain that, we have to have an acceptable SEDS. So The SEDS is all based, for obvious reasons, on what is going on in the region today. And as all of you know, I think, the Cape has been struggling for several decades on managing the dramatic growth that we saw starting in the 60s and 70s. We have seen a reversal, which is consistent with national trends, but more extreme on the Cape, of demographic groupings, so that we have a larger percentage now of people who are over 45 versus those who are under 45. So we have the three major sectors that relate to the tourism economy and the fact that we are a strong draw for retirees. So healthcare constitutes 18% of our employment, and then accommodation and food service and retail trade follow that closely. So that's 51% of our total employment base are in those three sectors. Wages in those sectors vary. Obviously, the strongest are in the health sector, and that's where most, you know, most of the jobs are also year-round jobs. It's the most consistent employment base all year round. The accommodation and food service and retail trade are more seasonal, and there are more part-time workers. The average weekly wage may, in fact, be a little bit higher than what you see here because there are a lot of part-time employees, and they count them as a full-time when they calculate the average. So, and those wages are competitive with those across the nation. That said, we do have a high cost of living on the Cape, which is led by the cost of housing. These blue bars represent what the average homeowner on Cape Cod could afford if they were to buy a new home. And this is what the average or the median home price is for homes currently on the market on Cape Cod. And in fact, I think I said currently, but I think these are actually a year or two old. So it's more dramatic now than even in this image. We have a lot of coastal and natural assets that drive our economy, but we also have some challenges with our vulnerability to climate change and the fact that many of our highest assessed valued properties are within the flood zone and are therefore at risk. And those represent both commercial and residential properties. We have also have postponed major infrastructure, particularly in the wastewater area. And the results are that we have 34 embayments that are over-fertilized, and we have to sort of retroactively correct that situation. And that adds to the cost of living because it requires us to build new infrastructure. So that's the context that we're working in. The SEDS process itself is pretty straightforward. We start with a vision that the BCEDC works on, but we also adopt the growth policy from the regional policy plan. And then the goals are based on the regional policy plan as well. So there are six goals in this plan that are derived largely from the goals that exist in the RPP. So that framework is then used to develop an action plan, and that's where we really bring in a wide variety of stakeholders to develop a series of initiatives, and then within each of those initiatives, particular projects that we think are going to advance the region's economy over the next 5 years. Finally, we lay out in this document a structure for evaluating our success annually. And then each year we complete an annual report that uses the evaluation process outlined here and the measures outlined here to gauge our success. So the organizing principles in a little bit more detail: the SEDS vision, cultivating creativity and diversity and innovation to build a strong and resilient economy, is the tagline that the BCEDC came up with, and really looks to Cape Cod to preserve and protect and build the year-round economy, the locally based economy, to to expand sort of economic resilience and the resiliency of our infrastructure so that we can move forward while still protecting those things that make the Cape unique and special, our natural assets and historic character. So these are the goals of the regional policy plan and the SEDS, and they, like the regional policy plan, are divided into those three systems. The one goal that's unique to the SEDS is under community systems, the regional collaboration and joint commitment goal. The fact is that this document, this plan, this strategy could not possibly be implemented by the Cape Cod Commission alone, and has to rely on our partners throughout the region, from the towns to nonprofits to private businesses, to actually see the results of this plan. So at the kickoff meeting in January, we had over 50, maybe 60 stakeholders there, and they went through a whole process of looking at what the strengths and weaknesses, opportunities and threats are for the Cape going forward. Strengths and weaknesses being things that are internal to the Cape, and opportunities and threats are things that would be coming at the Cape from outside. So through that process and then a prioritization process, a set of regional priorities were developed. So there are 9 of these, and I shouldn't think any of these would be a surprise. A number of them have to do with infrastructure, both the wastewater infrastructure, but other types of infrastructure, including broadband and transportation. Looking at how to work with our educational partners and workforce development partners, as well as business development partners, to support activities that will increase wages and employment opportunities on the Cape was a strong one. And then regionalization, zoning and regulatory reform, and then expanding financial resources for infrastructure were all things that towns and governmental bodies could work together on to create greater efficiency, and then also allow for growth within activity centers where it can be managed through infrastructure, and then also to protect our natural areas. And of course, as is true in many conversations on the Cape today, housing diversity and affordability was a major priority as well. So the action plan itself, again, this was created by subgroups of the stakeholders in working groups, and they identified 9 initiatives, which are very similar in some ways to those regional priorities, but a little bit more refined, and then underneath each of these are a whole series of individual projects. So the comprehensive and activity center planning, the housing access and affordability initiatives, both look at how to sort of use these activity centers where we have resources to try and address some of our larger problems with affordability. The blue economy sector development and climate change initiatives look at what our assets are and our challenges are related to being a coastal region, and capitalize on those by creating business opportunities to both adapt to and mitigate climate change going forward, and to increase the resiliency of businesses on the Cape. Local business development builds on that as well, looking specifically at how we can garner resources to help locally grown businesses and entrepreneurs. And then the last 4 all relate to infrastructure. The first is just general planning of infrastructure. The second really focuses on the transportation sector and what can be done there to help mitigate some of the greenhouse gas issues that we have. And then infrastructure development are projects that actually involve building. And then infrastructure funding is really looking at new sources of funds for infrastructure development. Infrastructure can also be, you know, housing can fall under infrastructure, so I think that the funding element comes up in that context as well. So that's the larger action plan, and then each year we have to set forth a sort of a more tactical plan about how we, the Cape Cod Commission, are going to go about implementing this plan in the year to come. So our year one plan is based around four general areas, as it has been for a number of years. The first is administration and general planning, where we work with the BCEDC. They meet quarterly, and they also are the stewards, managers of the Cape and license, Cape and Islands license plate grant funds. So they would be involved in helping to fund partners of ours, hopefully in completing some of the projects identified in the SEDS. And then the general planning is work that we do on a regular basis, working with towns on the Cape Cod Commission, on the use of Cape Cod Commission tools such as DCPCs and growth incentive zones. Outreach and information sharing is an essential part of our mission in the economic development area, but also in other areas where we try and disseminate as much of the federal data as we can. We're actually an affiliate of the Census Bureau's State Data Center Network. And we do that through Stats Cape Cod and other elements of our website, through the GIS department, and then through our One Cape Conference, for example, and other outreach activities of that sort. Technical assistance to towns is largely our RESET program, which hopefully most of you are familiar with. The RESET program came out of the 2009 Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy, and actually, it came out of an EDC grant program that worked closely with towns to try and really direct attention towards certain impediments to economic development that they were facing in their community. So we do that by bringing in all the variety of different staff that we have, from our transportation engineers to our GIS and planners, and then our water resources specialists and natural resource specialists. So through that program, we'll be working on implementing some of those larger planning projects that focus on activity centers. And then specific SEDS regional initiatives and projects are the fourth element of our annual work plan. And examples of what we're going to do this year, let's see, I think I have it on here, include the activity center planning, working with the Arts Foundation on completing a creative economy study and trying to integrate the creative economy into all aspects of our larger economy. We also will be completing a regional capital plan and housing plan, or at least initiating those. And then we will be completing, we've already got a project underway that Heather Harper has been leading on working with communities to identify building designs that they're comfortable with, but that could accommodate greater density in terms of residential housing. So we'll continue that, and then we'll also continue the work that we've been doing with towns on climate change mitigation and adaptation through the state's MVP program and through the previous disaster mitigation efforts, and then other elements going forward as they evolve. So then the final step, again, is the annual evaluation framework. And very simply, we look at three different aspects of the SEDS. The regional progress element, it really is a long-term review of how our economy is doing, and that's based on largely federal data, where we compare ourselves to Massachusetts and the United States to see how we're doing on things like wages, employment, gross regional product, and the like. And then we also look at the regional distress factors that the EDA identifies as qualifying criteria for federal funding from EDA. Then we look at how well we're working with our partners to accomplish the action plan. And finally, we look at the individual projects that we committed to complete in our annual plan and see how well we've done. And each project and initiative in the SEDS has specific measures identified. in the plan itself already. So that is a brief overview of the SEDS, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have or elaborate on anything that you're interested in.
Thank you, Leslie. Are there any questions from any of the commissioners that Elizabeth?
Sort of a circuitous question. And I don't know what's going on with changes in zoning that they were going to do on the state level, zoning reform. And a lot of that makes a big difference as to what we can do locally. I don't know if anything's happening there, but I hope somebody's pushing on it. Because a lot of the changes that could be done locally to help in a lot of these areas really are only allowed to work within the current state framework, so that would be, really help.
Yes, I believe that is still, you know, being discussed or will again be
discussed. It's been up there
discussed.
For years.
you know, I don't know any of the details of that area, but I do know that the Cape, because of the Cape Cod Commission and some of the tools that we have, is actually in a much better situation relative to being able to change zoning and work within the current state rules than most regions across the Commonwealth. And we continue to work with towns to help them, like for instance, Eastham, use the District of Critical Planning Concern tool to help them pass zoning changes this year, and they passed incredibly easily and well. And part of that was the tool, but also part of it was the fact that we were able to do 3D visualizations and do a whole outreach process associated with that.
Thank you.
I can, but I don't know if it records properly. Can somebody show them which button?
Okay, here I am.
Great.
I was at Chatham Town Meeting. They had a warrant article on to allow for ancillary apartments or stuff like that. And the numbers of among the groups who were sponsoring that were the Cape Cod Commission.
You're talking about the accessory dwelling bylaw,
right. Yeah.
And the Cape Cod Commission was involved with the Smarter Cape group, and that was an initiative that Smarter Cape felt was important, and asked the commission to draft a model bylaw, okay. Which we did, and then that was shared with all the towns, and then I believe it was the Realtors Association, which is a Smarter Cape partner, sort of took the lead on sort of working with towns, marketing the idea. The commission did not do that in particular.
So you just basically responded to them by drawing up a proposed bylaw, but you didn't. You're not really advocate for it. I mean,
Heather Harper is the housing person, so she may have something different to say. But you know, from an economic development perspective, housing our workforce is a real challenge, yeah. And we have developed in a suburban style way that. So we need to look for a variety of solutions to that problem. And because of the way, you know, the dispersion of our development, auxiliary dwellings are one way to do that because, and they also have other benefits as well to the homeowner.
Yeah, I supported that. I got a lot of grief from some of my supporters. But the one thing I didn't do, and I wondered if the commission did that, is to crunch the numbers as to what it would cost. If I were a homeowner and I had a little room over here, and I said I wanted to build one of those apartments, 900 square feet, what would it cost me? What would be the carrying cost of the mortgage? Mm-hmm. You know, what would it be economically feasible for me to do that? And my own fault, I didn't do that research. I don't know if the research was done at all.
No, I don't. Well, I think that, I think that having the option on the books will tell, you know, the market will then respond. And if it's not feasible, given that the way that that particular language is crafted, it won't be used like the previous auxiliary bylaw.
Which had no responders at all.
Right, because they couldn't necessarily make it work financially. And, you know, it will be different whether it's in your house or outside of your house, whether depending on your lot, and, you know, there are all sorts of unique characteristics.
It seems the advantage would be at new construction, because if you're building a new building, to incorporate another 900 square feet would be less expensive than, let's say, if you had to start from scratch.
Right.
I don't mean to get into this,
but it's recent,
and I know...
I could talk to you about this for hours, but maybe we should...
Yeah, I don't think we'd appreciate that.
No.
I have one more thing.
Cheryl?
We've had an accessory bylaw on the books of Brewster for a while, and we just came up with a new one. But as Ron mentioned, a big issue is the fact that it sounded like a wonderful thing to do. I mean, I have a barn, and I'd love to turn the second floor into an accessory dwelling. But codes have changed. You have to totally change a lot of the structure. And even if it's in your house, once you start to rent it, you fall under a whole new category of, you know, coming in under, you know, on in compliance with the code. And it would be nice if there was some structure out there to provide financial assistance to people who want to do this, because otherwise, you know, you hope people are going to flock into the building department and want to do this, but it's really expensive. Even if it's inside your own house, you have to totally change a lot of the fire protections, and you may even have to sprinkler in your house, because the rules and regulations when you start to rent are totally different, different fire codes and everything. So it would be nice if there was a financial solution out there to help people, you know, low-term loans
or grants, that
type of thing.
You know, a lot of the you know, Heather would probably be better at this than I am, but I know towns are working, have directed a lot of funds towards the housing issue in this last round of town meetings. And, you know, that might be one way that they could use those funds. You know, I think that people are aware that the building codes are challenging. They're important because they wouldn't be there if it weren't for, you know, if they weren't for our safety. But at the same time, it does make renovations, and it increases the cost of construction, which is already very high on the Cape. So.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Cheryl.
This might be a curveball.
I wouldn't expect anything less.
Thank you. Yes, I have a reputation to take care of. But it goes like this. The infrastructure we have, and I think this may affect the Lower Cape more than the rest of the Cape, but I could be wrong. The infrastructure we have, sewer, water, trash, parking, everything, is designed for peak. So that means for Provincetown, it's about the third week of August. Except in January, wow, you know, we've got an amazing amount of capacity to tolerate growth or economic development between sort of pretty much the school year, you know, September through June. And so the conversation was, gee, what if we had a reverse to what we all know, meaning that in my town you can pull a seasonal. You can have a seasonal business. What does that mean? Usually May to October. What if we had the reverse, which is just the school year, and then in the summer, you're closed? Have you ever heard that conversation?
I haven't heard that particular conversation. I mean, I've heard more about how do you attract people during the off season.
We're taking it a little step further, because the problem, if you don't deal with it, is you're adding to your summer. And we can't, so, because we're at peak. So anyway, I just wanted to put it out on the table, because you folks may end up wanting to talk about this yourselves. I mean, of course, that's one of the reasons why everybody starts talking about a college or education, because of the school year. But it's absolutely, you know, it's just astonishing, all this capacity, and it sits there doing not much in the wintertime. So I just wanted to put it out, since We're talking about it.
I think it's hard on the infrastructure sometimes, too, that's designed for year-round use, and it's not being used year-round.
Not at all, that's right.
But, yeah, and I think that's why on the Cape, we've made a real effort to look at, you know, these infrastructure questions in a creative way and thinking of, you know, alternative solutions so we can have a mix of solutions, because we do have that unique problem.
Thank you again, Leslie. While all of these conversations are productive, and it's one of the reasons we're here as commissioners, let's try and remember that the reason we're here for this agenda item is to consider the report and vote it up or down. Thank you.
Len, did you have a...
Len?
One of the major concerns that I've had for a number of years is we have a lot of housing here that is seasonal. And one of the reasons that it is seasonal is because there are a lot of people who would like to live here year-round, but we don't have the infrastructure to support them. Now, that could be wastewater, and it could be a lot of other things, but one of the major things that would help to get higher-paying jobs and also year-round people would be if we would get the fiber optic, the One Cape, in place and have that available so that people could actually work from home. And that today, that's very, very, very possible. You know, we're almost there, but it's not really all that efficient at this stage of the game. And it could very simply be moved forward.
Yeah, I think you'll be happy to know that that was a major point of discussion. It's one of the regional priorities that was identified in this plan, and that there are multiple projects and initiatives in here to work on that, to look at both sort of what the best organizational ownership structure would be best for getting that last mile connection, because we do have Open Cape. So we do have that middle mile network. So we're halfway there, or maybe a third of the way there. It's just getting it hooked up to all of us, the end users. We're looking both at you know, how the ownership structure could be done to make that financially viable, and then also some of the actual funding for build out and how you would get that funding. I think it will require public investment. It's not something that the private market is going to accomplish on its own.
Tom.
In the 2019 to 2024 timeframe, where does that initiative kind of fall? Is it something that's early on or something that's towards the end in terms of the build out on the One Cape?
I believe it's early on because it's already underway. You know, there's already discussions happening about structure and you know, I'd have to flip through my document here. But, you know, it's something that we're already working on, we being sort of the larger community, the county, the commission, Open Cape, and then other stakeholders.
Thank you.
Yes.
Feel I shouldn't just sit here and not say anything. I mean, the county has had some discussions with Open Cape, and as far back as several months ago, as how to go forward, what kind of structure they have, and what kind of help they would need, and whether the county should be, Barnstable County should be more involved in the process as a public entity to get the kind of support we need from the legislature and from the public sector. So the answer is we are... For government, we're moving, you know. We're moving it in a rapid pace for a government entity, as rapid right. as can be expected. So,
and I should just mention, you know, one of the reasons that we do this plan is because it helps us to leverage federal funding. And Open Cape was the top priority in the 2009 SEDS, and that did help us get the federal funding, you know, the millions of dollars that we received to build that network. So,
thank you again, Leslie. Any further staff presentations? If not, I'll ask for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I have the motion. I move the Cape Cod Commission approve the final comprehensive economic development strategy five-year update document for the years 2019 to 2024 and direct staff to submit it to the United States Economic Development Administration.
And we have a motion and a second, I'm hoping.
Second.
Thank you. At this time, we're going to follow a roll call vote and also use the electronic voting as well. So I'll ask you to please acknowledge when your name is called and also use the panel in front of you to either vote yes, no, or abstain with those lights that are lit there. Thank you.
Are they going? Okay. Mine's not lit. All right. Barnstable, Fred Girigotis.
Yes.
Bourne, Stephen Mealy.
Yes.
Brewster, Elizabeth Taylor. Yes. Chatham, Tom Wilson.
Yes.
Dennis, Richard Roy.
Yes.
Eastham, Joy Brookshire.
Yes.
Falmouth, Charles McCaffrey.
Yes.
Mashpee, Ernest Virgilio.
Yes.
Orleans, Len Short.
Yes.
Provincetown, Dr. Cheryl Andrews.
Yes.
Yarmouth, John McCormick Jr.
Yes.
County Commissioner Ronald Bergstrom.
Yes.
You gotta hit your button.
I did a couple times, sir. Am I hitting the wrong one? You hit the plus, right?
The second one from the left on the top row.
Is there color on?
No.
Yeah, you got a malfunction.
Story of your life.
That's the wonders of our electronic age. At that point in time, I will ask if there is any new business that should come before the commission. Seeing none, I think a motion is in order to adjourn.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?